I have the pleasure this evening of introducing our next speaker, Donna Morton. Donna is the founder and executive director of the Center for Integral Economics based in Victoria, BC. Donna has been doing work in the nonprofit sector for over 20 years. She has been a recipient of the Ashoka Fellowship in 2003, and this is a fellowship awarded to people who are perceived to be leaders in social action. Donna describes herself as a radical tax activist. You saw that taxes were very low on the public's list of issues they were concerned about, so naturally we want to take advantage of that and make it more important in a positive way. Donna's been an advisor to the mayor of Winnipeg, as well as the former New Democrat government in British Columbia. She's a dynamic speaker. She's here to talk to us, to help us realize the scope of possibilities that local politicians have to make a difference with the tools that are at your disposal. Donna is currently living in a yurt in northern Vancouver Island and personally campaigning for 911 service. Please join me in welcoming Donna Morton.
So this is going to be a really low-tech presentation. I've had some harrowing PowerPoint presentations where it failed me, and so I gave up the tool. And also, Cliff did a great job earlier today of making the case around climate change. Not that case, the case around climate change. So I'm actually not going to talk to you about why we should care about ending global poverty, why we should invest all of our leadership capacity in stopping climate change. I think you understand why we're in this room. Personally, I spent 20 years working on environmental and social sustainability. And I felt like every piece of work I ever did got stopped because the environmental community in particular didn't have answers to the questions of what we were going to do for a living in a sustainable world. What were the jobs going to look like? How were we going to pay for healthcare? How was I going to buy shoes for my kids? And so somewhere around 1994, I decided I needed to learn about the economy. I needed to teach myself how the economy worked. I needed to understand how tax policy, how subsidies worked. And so that's what I've been doing for the last 9 years. Taxes, for my organization, we describe as the DNA of the economy. They are an incredibly powerful underbelly. They drive decisions at the corporate and the individual level every day, billions and billions of decisions. So like DNA, they point people, they send these pulse points throughout the economy that you can't track easily and cleanly, but they make this enormous difference. And taxes also serve as this really important upstream strategy, because one of the things that I'm really convinced about is that we no longer have the time. Lots of people in the environmental community are talking about 20 to 30 years to fundamentally turn around the mess we're in. 20 to 30 years to decouple economic production from the destruction of planetary survival. That's what the Millennium Ecosystem said. We can no longer take for granted that the planet's life support systems will be there for us. That's a staggering piece of information. It scared me beyond anything that I've experienced over the last couple of decades. And then I realized that we are this incredible next wave of leadership, that previous generations ended slavery. They brought the vote to women. They brought the vote to First Nations. And so this is our challenge. How do we end global poverty, and how do we stop the attack on the climate and life support systems? I think we have 30 years, so we've got to work across issues, across sectors, across even political divides. And so there's something powerful about tax policy. There's something powerful about it, and that's why so much of us are repelled by it. You know, money is neutral. Economics and economies can be neutral. Tax policy can be a neutral zone for us to have profound conversations. But as progressives, I think many of us have decided that economics, in many cases, and certainly on the right side of the political spectrum, the taxes are, you know, these dirty things, this negative buzz. And so I think it's time that we really firmly, in North America, took the tax debate back. And that's what we've been trying to do for the last few years. We've been trying to start a public dialogue. We started doing work with politicians. We had some really interesting experiments with the BC provincial government. They were being really bold for a while around reinventing taxes and lining them up with sustainability objectives. Glenn Murray, who was then the mayor of Winnipeg, I think was one of the bolder politicians in the last 10 years. He was willing to take on the conversation around taxes, willing to step up and lead using the power to tax, which is the most powerful set of tools that I would argue any government has, particularly because of trade agreements. And I've had this conversation with a lot of different progressive people. It's not that I don't think regulations matter. Regulations matter enormously. But we have seen in recent decades an erosion of our ability to pass adequate legislation. And that's where taxes come in as a really interesting, radical set of tools. They are an end run around trade agreements. You can mess with taxes, even if you can't convince upper levels of government to regulate poisons, to regulate toxic materials. And so we've been trying to ring that bell and get people more interested in taxes. I think this time will be remembered for people being really bold, for people risking political capital, for facing really dark information. It is dark, and it has particularly young people really scared. I do a lot of work with young people across Canada, and they're really, really afraid. They're afraid that this generation of adults is not going to act, that we're just going to keep talking about the mess we're in, that we're going to keep publicizing information and running from our ability to make changes. And I think I want to tell them a different story. I want to tell them that this group of people, leaders, us, that we're going to seize this moment and we're going to do these really profound things. As government leaders, you set the rules of the game. You control the rules that establish your local economies. And it doesn't mean that you initiated them. We know you didn't build the economy as it is. But you can build the next economy. You have the aptitudes. And tax policy, like other forms of economic architecture, which is how I think about taxes and economic structures, they shape our places. They create places that are beautiful or ugly, places that inspire dignity or that leave people out in the cold. And so there's this incredible opportunity. I think there's another important space that's opening up between sectors. I've also spent a lot of time talking to the progressive business community. There are lots of small business leaders that want to support progressive politics in this province and in this country, and even in the United States. I just came from meetings with Paul Hawken and some really visionary people named Kenny Azubel and Nina Simons, who founded the Seeds of Life company and then something called Bioneers, which is an amazing conference that happens in the US and then gets broadcast across different satellite cities in North America. These are business people, but they feel about poverty and they feel about climate change the way we do. They want to be part of building solutions, and we have to build those bridges. Nonprofit organizations actually grew faster than dot-coms in the 90s, but was never reported. The nonprofit sector is a hotbed right now of people wanting in, wanting to share leadership, wanting to demonstrate leadership. And so I think there are these unprecedented new opportunities to build unusual coalitions across sectors, across issues, across the divides that have kept us far apart. But I think the prerequisite to really building those coalitions comes down to something I learned from Mike Harcourt, the principle of sharing power, sharing decision making. And the core process, which I was involved in when I was still a youth, that was a while ago, was a very profound experience for me. The idea that you have these very diverse sectors all collaborating their diverse pieces of the truth with the idea that together we would invent something better, that the decisions that we would make in our individual sectors would be inferior to that which we could bring to the table together. I'm a big fan of the book, The Wisdom of Crowds. I think it's an incredible resource for thinking about how we can change the face of local governments. But I do think it is about sharing power. It's about opening up the books. I'm very inspired by places like Porto Alegre in Brazil and the participatory budget movement. The local government in Porto Alegre invited people in. They said, we don't know everything. We don't know how to fix everything that's broken in our community. What do you love? What do you want for your place? And that's what we're trying to do with communities. What are your top 10 lists? The highest aspirations for your place? Sky high. What do you want this place to be remembered for? What's precious about your place? What's authentic? And list those things. And then simultaneously, what's the most broken? What are the most egregious problems, the worst 10? What's causing suffering in your community? What's keeping people apart? What's stopping you in your tracks? And then we reveal code on their current economic infrastructure. And it becomes very clear to the public that everything they aspire to, everything they dream of being in a community, is actually held back by the current tax system. Everything they aspire to is blocked by their current tax system. And it's true of in every community across North America. Our economic architecture is working at cross purposes with everything we love and contributing to everything that's harming our communities. But there's a magic in people getting it. There's a magic in people not feeling afraid about economics, not feeling disempowered, and particularly women in marginal communities. There's a magic that comes over communities where they realize that they've been kept back from this information. We live in a society where economics is held by economists who serve like priests. They interpret the word of economics. And even people like us, even elected politicians and social change activists, we're not supposed to mess with economics, right? It pretends to be this hard science. It pretends to be this solid body of evidence that stands the test of time. And there's something incredible about watching people get it, watching people come alive because they understand for the first time what taxes are doing to harm their community. And all of a sudden, you have this permission to have a reasoned, intelligent conversation about taxes and economics. And it can transform communities. And that's really what we're seeing around the globe. We've spent some time as an organization shopping the globe, not for stuff, but for best practices. And what we've started to see, yes, in Brazil, in places like Curitiba and Porto Alegre, but also in the EU, through countries like the UK, where they've adopted congestion charges, where you actually have to pay money to enter the heart of the city during high traffic areas, that it actually is transforming the way people see economics, and they see the benefits. People don't necessarily love it. I mean, we did a lot of person in the street interviews with hairdressers and cab drivers, which is where I like to get most of my data about economics. And people say, you know, I hated the idea of congestion charge on the surface, but I have to admit, London's better. My London is better. It's saner. There's less congestion. People can move around. There's less large vehicles. Taxes can deliver powerful change to communities. But we've expanded to look beyond taxes over the last couple of years. And we've also been looking at complementary currencies. When you look at Brazil and some really amazing turnarounds in the United States and even communities like Salt Spring in BC, there's a role for alternative currency. There's a role for matching up the needs of society and people that are left out of the dominant economy with a way of offering them currency that they can exchange for goods and services in their community. It localizes the economy in ways that are really profound. We also, I had the privilege through Van City and SFU to go to Emilia Romagna, the district around Bologna, several years ago. And it was incredible to see an economy that was 40% driven by co-ops and credit unions. 40% of all the economic activity in that region is done through credit unions and co-ops. And this is a place that doesn't have a decent economy. It's not just a decent economy within the EU standard. It's one of the best economies. And they make, the world's best. They make prosciutto ham, they make balsamic vinegar, they make Ferraris, they make Maseratis, they make Gucci shoes. I mean, the guy at the Bologna Chamber of Commerce, when you ask him about the success of his place, and what do you do? How are you marketing this brand, this incredible brand that you've created? He says, we don't do anything. We go into the showroom and we say, we are the Bolognese, we make the best, this is what it costs. Stop. It's an economy that is choosing to race to the top. It's an economy that has decided it won't compromise people or community in order to have a vibrant economy. I think that's one of the tragedies of North America, is that we live in this illusion that by trading on the environment, trading on jobs, trading on a social safety net, it buys us this fabulous economy. Our economy is not better than the Bolognese, than the Emilia-Romagna economy. It's worse. Right? Our economy in Canada, as I say probably far too often for the federal government, is a blue chip banana republic. Right? We teach the developing world how to build an economy based on high throughput of stuff and very few jobs. Right? We still have this very primitive economy. It's only because there's not a lot of us in the big, huge number of resources and lots of space that we have the illusion of living in this sophisticated industrialized nation. It's not true. And I think it's time that we, as progressives, started to admit that internationally. And I've been saying that a lot in the US and in other countries, that I'm not proud of the Canadian economy. I'm embarrassed of the Canadian economy. I'm not just embarrassed of our social standing, our social standard in the OECD dropping, our environmental standards through the OECD ratings dropping. I'm actually embarrassed of our economy. It's lightweight. It's not robust. It's not based on value. It's not based on quality. It's not an exquisite, authentic expression of who we are as a people. And I think we have to change that. I think we have to fight to change our economy as much as we have to fight to change social and environmental infrastructure. Another economy that I got really excited about recently is some of the innovation in South Africa. There's a South African nonprofit organization called the Johannesburg Housing Company that was just cited as the world's best example of housing. They won the World Habitat Award through the UN Habitat Program. And they did it by putting homeless people into empty buildings. That's one of the magic pieces. I mean, they also build sustainable infrastructure. They do a lot of really good work at stimulating progressive housing. But they refuse to leave buildings in the downtown cores of cities boarded up when there's people sleeping on the streets. And I think that's a really important idea for us to chew on. We all live in places, or many of us live in places, where the downtown core, Victoria's a great example, there's lots of boarded up buildings in our downtown core. And I think there are ways to tax people out of land speculation, which is what boarded up buildings represent. And I think there's other tools. I think there are ways and means for us to decide that people that don't have jobs can be paid through alternative currency, and we can turn empty buildings into different kinds of currency if we're really creative. And I think that's really the challenge of this next period of time. I think we have to get messy. I think we have to be uncomfortable with not knowing. I think we have to allow ourselves the agony of living in a culture that's in a huge transition, because I think that's where we are. And so I think it's important to name that. This is a messy time, and we're only going to fix these problems, I think, through really diverse kinds of creativity. I'm a big fan of drawing on the creativity of those most left out of the economy. I think there are big answers in marginal communities. I think there are big answers actually on First Nations reserves for some innovations that we need. I think there are enormous answers held by people who have spent time in prisons. I think there is incredible creativity possessed by dumpster divers and people in the sex trade and people that we don't even talk to when we are considered leaders in society. And I think it's time that we start judging our economies by who we've brought in that's been entirely left out historically. And so that's one of the challenges that I would sort of put out to all of you as local leaders. How could you look to tap the creativity of people who have survived in the margins because they know things? They know things about how to survive. They know things how to do something amazing sometimes with absolutely nothing. And there's this incredible wisdom, I think, across sectors again. I think artists, activists, and entrepreneurs haven't really been fully engaged in how we flip the switch on global poverty and climate change. I think the conversations are just starting, but I would argue that in as much as we have broken economic architecture, we have really broken social architecture. We don't know how to talk to each other. We don't know how to build the big tents. We don't know how to build ways and means so the politicians aren't alone in leadership, but they're supported by large numbers of really diverse people who all bring their stones to the table in order to make something more profound. I'm also a big fan of Jane Jacobs. I think her loss from the intellectual life of this country is big. It was big for me personally. She had some wild ideas about places that I think she called zone-free zones. And I guess I am attracted to the idea of modifying some of what she said and looking at how could we build radically green zones in our communities where we break all the conventional rules, where we postpone all the conventional bylaws and the zoning restrictions, and we say, get messy, get creative. Build yurts, build 300 square foot earth-based homes that you build with your own hands, and we're going to allow compost toilets instead of sewage systems. I mean, I think we need to be that out there. I think we need to look for really radical solutions. And I think we need processes that hand power back to the public. There's something wanting to happen right now. And particularly when we talk to young people, there's this starvation for how do we come in? How do we get invited by this generation to put our hands and our values onto economics and the rules of the game? One of the things that I'm really excited about this year, a little overwhelmed about, but really excited about is we put in a proposal to the National Film Board several years ago to make a film that would study global economic best practices. Where are the places in the world where communities are doing that, where they're taking back their local economy, where they're learning to match up their values and their aspirations with economic structures? And several years ago, the NFB, you know, they were mildly interested, but they said there was, you know, no box office for a film of that sort. And then Al Gore won an Oscar. And my phone rang, and it was the producer at the NFB saying, "We always really loved that idea. We talked about it for months and months, and we thought it was a really, really great idea, and now we've decided it's our new number one project." So we're about to go on a bit of a crazy train, burning way too many carbon molecules. But working mostly with local film crews to study global best practices. So we'll be looking at models in India, Brazil, South Africa, Scandinavia, the UK, and mostly African American and First Nations communities in Canada. Because part of our goal, if we're really going to democratize the economy, if we're really going to tell the story that the people can own economics, there needs to be more women than men. There needs to be more people with more pigment than less. And there needs to be as many kind of marginal voices as there are sort of smarty pants white guys. But there will be some smarty pants white guys. And, you know, we've been really lucky. This, you know, the project is really... I like smarty pants white guys. I mean, I like lots of other people, but there's a role for smarty pants white guys. The most fun part about this project is we've also decided that we're going to build this linear documentary that, you know, tells this story, and we're going to enter it into the conventional film world, but we're also going to build a multimedia project. So you could go into the piece and you could say, I only want to learn from women. I only want to learn from people of color. I only want to learn from people that are from a working class background. I only want to learn from Brazilians. So you can have control over it. And then eventually we're going to put it out open source and people can upload. So the idea is that this project can live on and on and on and become a vehicle for people like all of you to tell the story of the wonderful things that you're incubating in each of your communities. And then the last little part about the film that I'm excited about is I'm also holding out in a bit of a battle with the NFB because I want the majority of the funding for this film to come from people. People like us. I don't want the majority of the funding to come from large corporations or really wealthy individuals, though we'll take a little bit of that money along the way, I'm sure. But I would like the target to be somewhere in the 75 to 80% realm, so that after you've come to this film and you're sitting there with your friends and family, the credits roll, and for 20 minutes, it's your name and the names of every person in your community that got excited about the project. And so that we actually democratize the process of building a film, so that the public owns the product that tells the story of people telling stories about owning the economy. And one of the last things I want to talk about is just this idea of storytelling. So when I got interested in economics, I admit that there was a part of me that for the first few years in this work felt like I had to sort of pretend I was an economist. I didn't say I was an economist, but I didn't, you know, play the game differently than trying to walk the talk and look like an economist. And then somewhere along the line, several years ago, I realized that there's actually something really powerful about talking about economics not as an economist. That there's something powerful about being a woman from a working class background who's decided it's my business. It's my business how the rules of the game work. It's my business if I feel our economy is pitted against the people I love in this world and future generations. And that actually we can all claim a new story for the economy. Because as I said before, economics is stories. And if economics is merely a collection of stories, that means it can have new authors this time. It means it can have authors that look really different than the people that built the current economy that we all live in. And if economics is stories, it means we can edit and hit Control-Alt-Delete. That we can have a fundamentally different relationship to the economy by thinking of the economy as nothing more than a collection of stories. So that's the main thing I want to leave with you, is this idea that you're not handed down from on high an economy in your local community that needs to look just like it does tomorrow. In fact, the economy that you've been handed tomorrow could look really, really different just with your hands on it. But imagine what it could look like with the hands of all of the brilliant and creative and desperate people in your communities that want in, that want their truth, their story, their experience, and even the love that they feel for their children reflected in economics. I mean, I know it sounds out there, but I actually think we can build economics that reflects love, dignity, beauty. I think it's actually part of what we're called to do in this time. I think we don't flip the switch on ending global poverty. We don't flip the switch on curbing climate change unless we decide that our economic infrastructure is going to mirror the most beautiful pieces of human beings. You know, when my son was born 10 years ago in a 56-hour labor, which was part of my commitment to the world, you know, the first thing I noticed about him was, you know, he was this beautiful thing. There was not a cell of malice. There was nothing unkind. And I think those of us in social justice and environmental movements, you know, we can get kind of bitter and tired, and we can sometimes lose faith in what human beings are. I can't read the newspapers right now because of the Picton trials. Like, I just can't expose myself to what's going on. But I think there's something magical about children and what children represent. You know, they come into this world beautiful, noble, whole. And I think there's something in what they are and what they represent in our society that can be transformative, and that we really can take the love for our babies and turn it into economics. And that's really the challenge I want to put out to you. How do you do that? How do you do that tomorrow? How do you do that for 25 tomorrows after that, and for 25 years after that? How do you own who you are as a whole, beautiful human being and make that economics? Because I really think that's possible. I think we're at the place where we can be that transformative in the work we do. And the last thing I want to say is, you know, becoming an Ashoka Fellow was actually a very moving experience for me. I had never heard of the Ashoka Foundation, and it's a global fellowship of people that work in the nonprofit sector that are seen as, I guess, people that are using the skills of entrepreneurs but to deliver social benefit. So I was a little crazy at first about the entrepreneur thing, but I'm over it. The thing that was so humbling about the process is I started meeting all of these social change activists from Brazil, from India, from South Africa, from Bangladesh, from Nigeria, from Liberia. People who had risked their lives to do this work. People who were actually unsafe the day they flew home because of the work they did. People whose parents or brothers or sisters or children were harmed because of their political convictions, because they spoke out, because they stepped up, because they were fighting to make the world better. And I realized that, you know, I have this chip sometimes on my shoulder about, you know, I've been doing this for 20 years and isn't the world fixed yet? And, you know, can I be a painter like I always wanted to be? But, you know, I realized I've never had my life at risk. I've never had to face that my child could be unsafe at school because of something I said on the CBC. And I was with some women from Afghanistan last week who said, you know, the greatest thing for them about having moved to the United States was they never were afraid anymore that their children wouldn't be alive while they were at school, that they didn't have to fear that their babies wouldn't be safe because of their political work. And so the last thing I want to say is that, you know, we have this powerful moment, this transformative, hotbed, difficult time in front of us. But we can come from powerful places together, reinvent the world, and we can do it without being at risk. And so we have to, because we have to do it for ourselves and our communities and future generations, and for all the people who do it every day and who aren't safe.